Okay. So good morning to all. Am I audible right now?
Yeah, you're audible.
Okay. So today we have with Professor Gabriel Simon Turtle, head of the Department of Commerce, University of Kerala. And Professor Simon Turtle is the Director of Internal Quality Assurance at IQAC, University of Kerala. And Professor Simon was the General Secretary of Indian Accounting Association, now acting as the Chief Editor of Indian Journal of Accounting, the journal producing by Indian Accounting Association. So he's acting as the Governing Body Member of Center for Development Studies, which is affiliated to JNU, New Delhi. I would say a very important person in our university, as well as very important person in the Faculty of Commerce and Management across the country. I say a very busy person who is dealing with multiple activities, multiple academic activities of our university. Also a leader who has the skill to influence others. I would say, in fact, I was motivated when I was studying and observing Sir's classes. Whenever and wherever the opportunity come, I do attend professor sessions, and sessions getting a lot of new ideas. A person with a lot of new ideas, he's taking part, taking part in the curriculum and other academic development activities of Kerala State Higher Education. He is the advisor of Higher Education Council, Government of Kerala. So I hope our sessions will be influenced to you. A lot of things to say about sir, but we can start session because sir is very busy, and 11:30 we will have an open defense session in our university. So you are going to experience, sir. I welcome Professor Gabriel Simon Turtle to the session. Thank you, sir.
Welcome. Thank you, Biju, and very good morning to one and all.
I hope I'm audible. You can all hear me.
Yeah, perfect, sir.
Audible. Okay, so we are discussing something under applied research in finance. So I'm sure across the country, all of you have been hearing a lot about disruptiveness in higher education, impact of technology, skill-based learning, blended learning, so on and so forth. Now, associated with the same, in the domain of commerce, finance, and management, most specifically in finance, we have been hearing a lot about the need for applied research. And I think the entire faculty development program on which you are actually focusing is related to this, because we are discussing econometrics, we are discussing business analytics. It's all about these issues in finance, financial services, financial markets, and so on and so forth. Now, being on the online mode, perhaps all of you would understand there are lots and lots of developments which are happening in terms of integrated financial markets, in terms of fintech services, in terms of e-commerce supported e-finance, and so on. So today we are trying to look a very quick look, or a quick peep rather, into applied research into finance. And I'm sure all of you know what is applied research, and it is quite different from our theoretical or conceptual research, or maybe just looking into the information part of it. Now, before I start with the presentation, I'll just discuss a bit, or I will try to just touch upon what exactly applied research is without directly going into finance. And then we'll try to look at how this gets added value and becomes more imperative when it comes to finance. Now, applied research is very simply using research for problem solving. So it is practically trying to use the inputs of research to resolve an issue which is contextual. We are seeing lots of applied research in terms of the COVID pandemic, in terms of the variant of the virus, and so on, the mutation that is taking place. So as far as the industry is concerned, as far as business is concerned, they have some genuine issues true issues which need to be resolved, for which they would like somebody to seek information, do your analysis, and tell us how to resolve an issue. That is applied research. Whereas the conventional or the theoretical or the conceptual research is just giving information. So we don't have a problem at heart, and we are just trying to gather information and provide information about something which whoever, if they want, they can use when they want. But here we are trying to have at the core a problem and trying to look at how this can be resolved. So this is exactly what we are trying to do in terms of finance, because considering what is happening in the domain of financial market, financial services, financial systems, and looking at the way these things are fast changing. Now, before coming for the session, I was trying to look at what I actually studied 30 years back in finance and what it is today. What is banking then? What is banking now? What is insurance then? What is insurance now? What was the capital market then? And what is the capital market now? A sea change has actually taken place over there in terms of dematerialization, in terms of fintech, in terms of blockchain, in terms of electronically embedded platforms for trade. And I was trying to just prioritize what exactly is the most important change which has happened. And to me, I don't know, you have to ponder over that because we're discussing applied research. Me discussing two changes, the market becoming integrated and getting driven by technology. That means today we conventionally we started learning, and perhaps your academic literature is now even now telling that the financial market is divided into money market, capital market. Money market is for short-term funds, capital market is for long-term funds. The capital market, you have the primary market, which is for IPO, and the secondary market, which is for the stock exchanges, so on and so forth. So it's all talking about segmented part. Now, today we are in a world where this is all getting integrated through fintech services. You have a same institutional support mechanism, which will provide you all kinds of financial services, be it banking, be it insurance, be it mutual fund, be it DMAT account, be it IPO, be it merchant banking, be it venture capital, be it angel investing. All the financial services gets integrated by a service provider. And you will see many of these things moving into the virtual mode. So it's all like anywhere, anytime. And they have specific issues. And the biggest issue that they are facing is innovative products and services and having a borderless space for your financial transactions. This is what we are trying to discuss today when we talk about applied research. Now, when I'm discussing this, in applied research, we have action research, which is actually problem solving. We have research and development, which is product and service development or innovation. And we have evaluation research, which is information for decision making. So applied research itself has three segmented divisions, where number one, you are focusing on problem solving. And that is, in fact, the key to applied research. That means we have a specific issue, how to deal with it. I want to integrate or penetrate with my financial services into rural India. And I encounter the issue of digital divide, which prevents or stands as an obstacle in my moving into a space which has got lots of potential. How do I do this? That comes from applied research. So those kind of research, where there is absence of financial literacy, where there is a mental accounting bias, which stands as a very severe obstruction in the way I look at finance and money, which is so strong, even in states like where general literacy is high, like the state where we are in. I'm not always understanding the implications of the market in terms of risk return trade-off, but I am driven by certain biases in terms of saying that, okay, something is always secure and something is always unsafe. So how do I break this barrier? This is all applied research about. What is the basic conceptual understanding of accounting, reports, and financial statements? Long back, we thought it was just consolidated reporting of facts. Now, applied research in accounting talks about how do we break this paradox and try to understand accounting as something which is inferential, analytical, something which has got an information database, something which supports integrated, consolidated representation of enterprises. That is applied research. So applied research is talking about deep understanding about problems and resolution of the same. Number two, it talks about research and development in terms of having innovative products, again in finance, innovative financial products and services. We were at one point of time talking about shares and debentures, redeemable, irredeemable, secured, unsecured and all. Today, every 6 months, you see something innovative happening in the capital market. We then subsequently talked about derivatives. We talked about options. We talked about futures. Then we talked about indices. Then we talked about fund of funds. We talked about indexed funds. We talked about exchange traded funds. We talked about commodity traded funds. On and on goes the list. So that is coming out of your applied research in terms of R&D. Just like it happens in science and technology with products and services. Then again, your evaluation research or your research in terms of information that gives decision, we need continuous information. And that information, as researchers and academicians understand, it is real-time data today. It is real-time data today. It is not always like you go to the respondents and you get, I'm not saying that it is not there, but beyond the primary data, beyond the secondary data, it is updated real-time data. If I start looking at the platforms where trading takes place, something which was there at 10 o'clock becomes irrelevant at 12 o'clock. Valuations suddenly change. You see sudden deep sinking. You see extreme levels of volatility, real-time data. And you have a huge database which tells you anything and everything that you want at any moment of time. What is the latest financial reports which were published? Which are the dividends which have been declared today? What has happened with the post-dividend 1 hour, 60-minute time scenario? Which are the board meetings which are taking place? Which are the AGMs which are taking place? What are the major decisions which are coming out? Real-time data available, which stands as a testimony for good research. So applied research in finance has got these three elements. Solid look into problem solving. Deep introspection into innovative financial products and services. And above all, how we can use real-time data contextually where we want it for a particular purpose. And that is what we actually need to look for in terms of the financial market and services as it stands today. And when it gets technologically embedded, when it gets digitally refined, it becomes more solid. That is what we are trying to look at in this brief session. And that is what has lots and lots of potential in terms of the future for this discipline when it comes to using it in the right perspective. On the other hand, or on the contrary, if it is not used in that line, it becomes highly disruptive. If I'm still saying that accounting is just ending with balance sheet preparation, or I'm still saying that I'm looking at the market in a segmented form, in a location, in a place, in a branch where products are given, and I'm expecting everybody to come to my branch during working times within a particular space under a roof, then it is highly disruptive. So this is what we are trying to talk about today. Now again, applied research in finance. We are trying to look at finding practical solutions to problems which actually emerge from certain domains. Look at those domains. one which I already just referred to, an integrated financial market. We are slowly moving away from that segments, saying that, okay, a bank is an institution which is only there in the money market, or an insurance company means it does only life insurance business, or a mutual fund is going to do only mutual fund business. If I today look at SBI, it does not have a sustenance if it does not do all these things. I can get my DMAT account for stock exchange trading through my SBI. I can also take mutual funds through SBI. I can take insurance products through SBI. I can do fund transfer. I can have merchant banking service. I can have commodity derivative services, maybe through the segments, but all through the same institutional setup. So it is integrated. I still remember my good old days where we started learning that even banking was segmented. The academic rich literature which used to tell us in banking, agriculture loans were given by agriculture banks. Export import credit is given by Exim Bank. And for industry, you have industrial banks. So different kinds of banks or segments within banking. Today we are talking about integrating a wide variety of financial services. That integration has got challenges. That integration has got opportunities, which are the true areas of applied research in terms of looking at what it happens. Because earlier, when I'm talking about branch-based or I'm talking about a time-based service, I'm trying to see my clientele, which happens in a space during a time. Today, that is not possible. We need to have a huge clientele base because you're providing anytime, anywhere service, and you're trying to integrate with a larger economy, with a bigger industry on a technology platform. So then mergers becomes important. Forging alliances become important. Entering into strategic partnerships become important. And that is where we are trying to look at applied research. And that is already happening in banking. We are seeing it happening in banking. We are seeing it how it happens using fintech services. We are seeing how it happens using blockchain platforms. All are the outcomes of solid applied research in finance. Again, technology-driven solutions for financial services. I already mentioned many of them. Wealth management solutions, very, very important. The concept of wealth, the concept of risk-return trade-off is entirely different today. Because earlier, we had a concept that only, okay, there are certain things which are always secure and certain things which are always risky. But today we have got numerous options in terms of different sectors, maybe the bond market, maybe in options, maybe through trade-offs, maybe through specific financial services like angel investing, crowd financing, through startup financing, in which there could be a case where, yeah, startups have got a huge risk of loss, but I don't mind going into angel investing and taking up 9 failures because the 10th success is going to reap me with rich advantage. So all these things are there in terms of how investors with wealth come out with ideas in terms of managing the same by looking at places where you can appropriately park your funds with good returns. Then innovative financial products and services, I told you, every now and then you see something new happening. A new kind of packaged, customized product, which is talking about risk at different levels. It can be sector-based, it can be industry-based, it can be an index fund, it can be relating to a particular kind of services offered abroad, it can be associated with foreign exchange, it can be associated with swaps. So all kinds of innovative things. And you continuously go on innovating and innovating using value addition in terms of the products that you have, based on the class of investors and the type of investors and the risk appetite which they have. So innovation becomes so great on that line. Use of information in finance and understanding psychology in spending. Here, finance get links to marketing? I think this is a very, very, very strong area for research, because, and this has been made all the more strong with the COVID pandemic. What is happening today? You look at applied economics, you look at modern behavioral finance, the underlying factor there is by and large human psychology. You look at all the major studies, including Nobel Prize winning studies in economics or in finance, there is something associated with, when I was referring to mental accounting, when I was referring to biases, psychology. And what I'm trying to bring here is cues of information in finance. Today, markets are getting built in terms of spending patterns. And spending patterns, when it is in a digital mode, there is a capturing of data relating to it. Now, if I use my net banking, and if I'm using my debit card, credit card for payments, or even Google Pay or the UPI platforms for payment, that information, the digital payments that have been made by me, or people like me who are in a particular age group, who are employed, you get to know that this much of digital payment happens for these kind of products. The kind of preferences which I have for FMCG products, for consumer durables, the kind of e-services which I have used, the spaces or the marketing spots which I have visited, the websites which I have taken. Now, this huge database which comes up can be used as a potential means to identify what the digital payments were made for, how the market is going to move in future. The youth will have these kind of preferences. Whether it is in entertainment or whether it is in textiles or whether it is in, you get to know that. That means the financial spending patterns are providing vital inputs to marketing. What kinds of product will be required? What kind of color preferences will be there? What kind of services will be required? That gets mapped. So information in finance for understanding the psychology in spending, which brings in finance marketing linkage. So based on this, that means the more and more you develop on your e-commerce digital payment platform, the more and more real-time data gets captured and you understand what influences whom at what point of time. So there is a strong movement from basic data to information and from information to knowledge. This is typically what happens in applied research. You have tons and tons of data which is coming out. That's why I said real-time data. You look at the different databases, digital payments, digital receipts, how it is going on, the DMAT accounts, the scripts which are taking place, the AGMs which are happening, the new spending patterns of different, all these data are coming out. Now, this data is just huge, tons and tons of data. When processed and analyzed, you get some information, you get some insights into maybe spending patterns, into future potential for certain products, into certain products which will not become necessary, certain marketing models which will become obsolete, certain emerging markets which will pop up. So you are getting information. You use that information and you contextually resolve an emerging problem. That is knowledge. So it's as simple as that. I'll just give an analogy or a comparison with something that happens in health. Suppose I want to know about the health of somebody in a particular college or institution. I first collect data. I might take the name and height and weight and blood group of students, and imagine there are 1,000 students. So I get 1,000 figures with me. 1,000 names, 1,000 height, 1,000 weight, 1,000 blood groups. I process it. I take the average height and average weight of boys and girls in the college, and I find out what percentage of them are overweight or underweight. Now I have some information with me. Then I go to the reasons why these students have become overweight or why they are malnourished or underweight. And I understand that these are the reasons for that. Based on that, I am trying to put in a solution for good health in that institution. That is knowledge. So what I wanted to put across here is the idea on how data came to be used and processed as information, and how this information came to be used for resolution of problems in a context. My context was that college. This can happen in a big way in finance. There are tons and tons of data which are very easily technologically embedded and captured on spending, on e-finance, on preferences, on ways people are investing, on savings that they are making, on the literacy that is coming up, on the response to the capital market, on the preferences for DMAT accounts, on the institutional and domestic kind of patterns that they have in use of funds. Those data will give you information, and that information is going to be focused on problem solving, which is knowledge. So this is another area where you see how applied finance is going to be useful in a big way. And I understand in this FPP, you're learning about business analytics, financial modeling, econometrics, and all. These are extended models of how this should happen. But often what happens in our teaching, learning, FDP processes, we try to see this as segmented. If at all we are learning financial modeling, if at all we are thinking about business analytics, if at all we are talking about big data analytics, it's all for this purpose. Resolving specific issues, transforming the huge database into action research. Emerging markets, emerging products, emerging opportunities, emerging business propositions. That is what we are actually looking for. Now, let me move on. We look at, and now I'm trying to put this, if this is applied research in finance, let us look at some of the changes both in the individual perspective as well as the market perspective in which we are trying to examine the same. What happens in the individual perspective? I already mentioned we are trying to use digitized payment modes. And that itself is giving us, like if you ask the government today or policymakers, they will tell you that individuals today make this much part of their payments in the digitized mode. Fine. From that, again, there are breakups, out of which this much is used for education, this much is used for health, this much is used for investment, this much is used for FMCG, this much is used for travel, so on and so forth. And again, from that, you know, these individuals, they are again classified into those who are salaried, those who are the different income groups, those who belong to the organized sector, any forms that you have. So this is something which is becoming imperative in terms of having applied research in finance on how effectively individuals can be guided on their action. And all these services are anytime services. It's not like anytime, anywhere services becoming so very important. It is moving into education also now in the blended mode. So it is like I have no specific time to say that when I will deposit, when I will take a decision. Yet there is trading time for the markets, fine. But I can place an order at any time. I can give an exit option at any time. I can give a switch option at any time. And maybe when I'm free, I do that. I might do it at midnight. I can make payments anytime. So you have that happening. Again, integrated services, I am not going to say that, okay, for this, I will log in into banking. Then from there, I'll go to portfolio and take a mutual fund over there. And if I want to sell my insurance, I'll go only to the insurance segment. They all will all happen on a real-time basis with one integrated platform. Again, the transformation which happens in the market. Market has to become supportive on that lines. And virtual space, all these facilities. Nobody wants to go somewhere, wait over there, fill a form, ask what should be done in the front office. They will give you an application form. This was the way we used to actually trade. So the market is giving you a virtual space. And when you're in a virtual space, again, you're integrated and you try to become competitive in your value-added services. If I don't get the downloading in 1 minute, if I don't get a service happening or a transfer happening between 2-3 minutes, I might switch over to another service provider. Earlier, I had only a branch which is near my house. Now I can go anywhere. I see this online. I go to some other service. You're taking this much time for adding a beneficiary or giving a service or transferring the fund. I might go to somebody else because it's all integrated. I'm in a virtual space. So market transformation, you have to become competitive, whether it is in your RTGS, whether it is in your core banking, whether it is in your fund transfer, whether it is in your innovative products that are claimed, whether it is in the support services that you give. You have to become fast reformative, because the difference between those who are in that market space cannot be significantly different. This is happening even now in education. I cannot say that, okay, I am in one institution, I'll always have my students coming to my university and classroom. Because students will have a large number of options, even without going to any classroom or university in a virtual space, they can learn. That being the situation, why should they come to you? And all those who are successful and existing are people who are competitively giving the best service. Markets will transform on that line. And e-business will create databases for financial service as a backup. The e-business is going to act, the e-business models will act as a backup in terms of telling you that this is where the future is going to be. This is going to be the like of preferences which are, if you look at the e-data that comes out in textiles, they'll be clearly in a position to actually map and tell you that this will be the kind of preferences in the south, this will be the preferences in the north, this will be the color choices that they make, because they're continuously seeing the visits that are taking place into the websites and the payments that are being made for products, the choices which are being taken, the returns which are coming up. So e-business is something which is going to have a big, a big backup as far as the individual's perspective is concerned. And that is also turning out to be applied research in finance. And financial models that emerge for investments based on risk return payoff. You look at all your financial modeling tools which are coming up, all the statistical packages which are supporting that. They are trying to balance the requirements of investors through a good risk return trade-off, where something is customized. You tell that I can take only this much amount of risk, or this is my amount, this is that I can save, this is that I can subject to risk, then there is always an innovative product ready for you. There is always an option or a space where there can be a benefit for you. And that is what we are actually looking at when we talk about these elements, or when we are trying to look at these elements, which are so very crucial. So the individual's perspective is going to be on that line. I cannot just say that, okay, I will sit and render my service for somebody sitting somewhere. I must always keep myself open to all that is happening around me in the environment, in the business space, that is existing for all. That is the perspective that is happening. That is the system that is actually happening over there. Here I'm also talking a bit about mental accounting, if you those of you who know about it. Now what we are trying to do is we are trying to remove the mental accounting bias that individuals basically have in terms of they are getting perfectly they turn out to be perfectly fungible in their allocation. That means, why I'm telling you this is because if you look at the conventional financial market products and services, it was by and large driven by some kind of a mental frame where we are under the belief that, okay, always certain things are good or always certain things are bad. So that mental frame, coming out of that mental frame and trying to understand that finance or money can change form in terms of what it can bring for you. There was a time where there was always a huge, if you look at the Kerala perspective, we used to have huge deposits lying in banks, in FDs and all. So people generally believe that the best way to park funds and get some returns was fixed deposits. And those were the days where maybe FDs carried an interest rate of 9%, 10% and all. But subsequently, over a period of time, now, when the rates have declined, that means it has come down to maybe 5%, 4 point something, and you are in a taxable bracket, which means that the interest that you get is again going to be taxed. And if you are in the 30% bracket, the 5% interest that you get is again going to be taxed at 30%. So what is the return that you're going to get? But still, if I'm continuing with this notion that law, this is my product, which I was holding for 10 years, 20 years, and I'll go by it. Let the interest be low, whatever. I'm not looking at the other options. So that is where I have in me a mental frame that, okay, if you have savings, this is the only way. Now, those biases, because of the huge inflow of information, the huge inflow of data that is coming up, perhaps everybody will get to know that this finance, this money is fungible. It can be allocated in the best possible way. So what do you mean actually by savings? What do you actually mean by investment? What is the whole lineup of choices which you have with you? So these things are becoming very, very important. So we become discretionary in your spending account or in your wealth accounting practices and in your investment practices. So there are lots and lots when we talk about your systematic investment plan, systematic withdrawal plans. So there are options where actually the psychological barriers and biases which have been formed over time because of the availability of information, you see a huge rise in that. If you look at the number of DMAT accounts with retail investors, you see a huge surge which has happened in the last 1 year. These are all indicators. These are all indicators for applied research in finance that people have understood that there are other ways. It is not that there is no risk, and it is not that there is no levels of looking at your commitments. But we need to understand what is the level into which you can subject yourself to risk. What is the level to which you need to have very secure investments? So same, if this is what the individual's perspective is, how is the market changing on that line? Whether you're offering insurance, whether you're offering deposits, whether you're offering mutual funds, when you come up with IPOs, how do you tap at these options which are coming up? So this is actually what we talk about when we look at those options. Again, financial markets, it's actually talking about wise deployment models. They should be good deployment models. It is not like, again, when I was 30 years back, 35 years back, when we used to study, it used to be like, what is banking? Accepting with one hand, lending with the another. Yes, it is that even today. But your deployment of funds, your wise use of funds is more important than raising funds. That's why I said when we talk about angel investing, when we talk about venture capital financing, these are all emerging areas in your applied finance. It is all wise deployment. And the way you deploy, the way you use is what is going to bring more funds for you. If you have not deployed, if you have not wisely applied, the chances of getting more funds, raising more funds are limited. And where you can deploy, it is not always in your immediate vicinity. You might have raised in some part of India, you might be deploying in some other part of the world. You might have raised from one sector, but you might see a viable startup model where you invest something. You look at what happened in the whole space when Uber was taken over Zomato, and when they came up with the IPO, how that model got up. Something running at a loss itself being financed by what we call the angel investors and financiers, the IPO finding success. So they are trying to see at emerging models which are there. And there could be some emerging models where you can deploy funds, and that the way you look at the potential for that sector is something where you see that, okay, future I will generate. So wise deployment. And that's why I said angel crowd financing, project financing is also on that line. Which are the viable projects? What is the information backing that you have to say that something is viable? Maybe it is not viable, but you see it viable in the next 5 years. And what is the backing that you have to say that, okay, after 5 years, this is going to be really useful and viable? What will be the fintech services in an integrated format? I already mentioned about that, because I want a one-stop, single window single window opening and one-stop solution for all my financial services. I cannot say, okay, today I'll go to, like conventionally I used to say, for banking, I'll go to a bank. For insurance, I'll go to an insurance company. For a mutual fund, I'll go to a mutual fund institution. For my project finance, I'll go somewhere else. For my information needs, I'll go to maybe a policymaker. So that kind of an integration, it'll all come up in one. You have your electronic ledgers and your platforms on financials. So that's what's happening in blockchain. So blockchain technology is coming up. Resolving the risk assessment models. That is why you're all looking at econometrics and financial modeling and all. The risk assessment models. How do I look at the best portfolio? How do I balance my risk? This is again dependent upon who is assuming the risk and who is hedging the risk. Who are the risk takers and who are the risk avoiders? And how do they stand in the market? You also look at the instruments in terms of the underlying product and the derivative product. How do they match up? So resolving assessment models in both individual and institutional investors. Now, what I'm trying to say, I'm not trying to, what you call, give you the conceptual understanding of these markets. What I'm trying to put across is how applied research in finance is trying to enter or poke into these areas. And that is where we understand the changes which are coming up and the resolutions which are matching up or picking up with them. Then return enabling models for both, again, individuals and institutions, which is the best way not to get 100% return in terms of the calculated risk which I take, in terms of my risk assuming capacity that I have, in terms of the standing risk appetite which I have, what is the enabling, return enabling model? So we have a number of, the market is ready with a number of customized models, and the services are there for different category of investors, be it individual or institutional. And that is where we are trying to develop our own foresights, our own thoughts on how this can actually emerge. So financial markets are taking this change. And as I said, this is happening in an integrated space. This is happening on a real-time basis. This is happening in terms of the industry economy linkages which are taking place. So that is the situation under which we are trying to look at applied research in finance. Then the financial service models that we are talking about, again, as I said, it is all integrated. It is in a virtual space. So what happens in a virtual space? Now, why do we have differentials in pricing? Suppose I want to buy 1 kilogram of tomato or 1 kilogram of brinjal. All of you are from different parts of the country. You know the differentials in pricing. Even in one city, one shop sells it at one price and another shop sells it at another price. Why? Even when the quality is the same, prices are not always the same. Within cities, between cities in a state, or between cities across the country, you will see the prices vary 20, 30, 40%. Their variation is there for physical commodities. The reason is there are lots and lots of factors which come up over there, including factors which are associated with convenience, factors which are related to the transportation. There are information barriers. I do not know that somewhere else price is low, somewhere the price is less, or I'm not sure about quality. So information barriers, there are convenience factors, there are locational factors. These are the factors which cause differentials. So say, for example, a shop does not have a parking space. I know that the quality there is good or the price is cheaper, but there is no parking space. So convenience is preventing me from going there. Again, I know that the price is less somewhere else or the quality is better somewhere else, but to travel there, I have to go for 15, 20 kilometers, which is difficult. These differences do not exist in a virtual space because I'm seeing everything on my laptop. or on my mobile. And I can see where, which product is available with the best value added support services. So there is no issue for me. I can get it at the best available. That you look at the differentials. Earlier I was talking about a kilogram of tomato or brinjal. You look at the differentials between the prices of equity shares, which are being traded at this moment, at this point of time, between NSE and BSE. It'll be very narrow. Because if the prices are different, the differentials are very huge, people will buy from the place where the price is low and arbitrage through selling at the place where the price is high. And this will create an equilibrium. So in the virtual space, you have symmetry in information. You have these factors happening very fast. And as a result of that, you get integrated. That's what I said earlier. You can't have differentials in quality. You can't have differentials in price. You have to be very competitive. This is happening in finance. And that is one area where your applied research in finance can happen. Again, the digital, same I mentioned about that. There is a swift movement of funds. If your IPO does not do well, perhaps if you have possibility for movement of funds, you can move funds from one bracket to the IPO. Or if your equity market is not well, you can go to the debt market. You can shift between insurance and your mutual fund options. And even in mutual funds, you can shift between sectors. So all those options are options which are actually going to help you in looking at finance in a very concrete form in terms of its applied research potential. Again, I was referring to how you can customize. You look at all the kind of earlier, what do you call, DMAT or what do you call, depository services which were offered. You have a depository, and under that you have depository participants. You look at most of the depository participants, maybe 5 years, 10 years back, what was their commission, what was their service charges, and what was the wide variety options which they have. Look at the same depository participants today, the commission or the prices or the brokerage charged are very nominal. The customized type of products which you need small cap funds, you need large cap funds, you need a blending between small cap and large cap funds, you need indexed funds, you need more bond and less equity, or you need to have more risk bearing products and less of bonds. What kinds of customized options are available? You want to have some kind of life protection through insurance, and you want to get some returns on a mutual fund. Can it be packaged together? Can you act as a priority service dealer? So all kinds of options, customized versions are available based on the investor class. I'm saying that I'm a low income person. I'm less prepared to take risk, or I have more risk aversion that is inbuilt into me. Accordingly, you move it. You have customized products for them. I might switch to more bond and gilt-edged or government securities, which still stand to give me a gain, which will be perhaps higher than the fixed deposits. So that is again based on how much I make myself financially aware and literate about the options which are available. And how I actually intend to do that is based on what the market is offering for me in terms of customization, based on the investment options which are there. Savings and investment, emerging priorities to be more knowledge based. That's why I said that mental vibe. One of the strong, markets which were used for different products and service in finance at one point of time was incentivized promotion. That means the sales for such products and services in the financial sector would push up only when the agents go and sell it in a very incentivized promotion base. What do you mean by that? They will come with their laptops with institutions. They will go on telling you that something is good, something is good, something is better. And because of their provocation, rather than your knowledge, you happen to take products and services. We are seeing this happening even in educational institutions. They come and do demonstrations before you. So it is not that this is insignificant, but beyond that, what is the knowledge that you have? Yes, we have offer documents and new fund offer documents and IPO documents, which gives lots and lots of information on risk factors as per SEBI guidelines, as per RBI guidelines. So there are options to get that information, process that and take information. But beyond that, what we normally do is we sign across the dotted lines. The incentivized promoter will come and tell you that you sign here, 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 and then your work is done. Rest, you give us one PAN card or one Aadhaar card, and from that we'll take and give you or fill out all the information on our own. So then that person, it is easier for that person to push his sales in terms of what he needs, rather than yourself understanding the implications of that product in terms of how it suits you. So this happens over there. Now, this is again something which has got the propensity to continue with such biases perhaps will change when we actually have a stronger knowledge base with us. So that is another model, or that is another important crucial factor when it comes to applied research and finance, where such changes are bound or are most likely to impact the financial scenario that unfolds before us. So that means we are going to be more educated, we are going to be more learned, we are going to be more understanding. It does not mean that rumors and herd behaviors and biases will not exist, but the propensity for that, or your being willing to perhaps change, will give you an opportunity to change. So that's what we are trying to bring about over there. Now, information base for accounting research. I'm moving into another area where applied research and finance is, what do you call, all the more crucial today. If you look at the index of disruptiveness in disciplines, the discipline which is ranked one there is accounting. One of the disciplines which are ranked as least disruptive is dentistry. So what do you mean by this? When you say accounting is ranked to be very high in terms of disruptiveness, it simply means that if you continue with your accounting research and education by understanding the basic processes alone, by saying that, okay, accounting is what? Journalizing, you post, you balance, you get your ledger prepared, you prepare your trial balance, and you prepare your profit and loss account and balance sheet. If that is what you do, then we are saying that this discipline has got a high disruptive value. Because disruptive values tend to be high when we are talking about the processes that go in the compilation or computation of something with the basic schools of thought relating to that. I'm just talking about the past history and the process. This theory evolved in this year, and this is how you do your journal, this is how you do your balance sheet, this is how you do your profit and loss account, you have your balance sheet, and the profit and loss account will tell you what is your financial, financial operations, whether you made a profit or loss, and the balance sheet will tell you your financial position, this is how it is prepared. Now, disruptiveness is low when you move into a futuristic model. That means I am talking about how this basic thing can be used in terms of how I can use this in terms of inferential, analytical, interpretational part. Again, your theme for this FDP. That's why I've linked all this to applied finance. You're talking about business analytics. You're talking about financial inferential learning. So the basic shift that is taking place in accounting and reporting is that there is a paradigm shift from computation and mere reporting of the computed values to becoming analytical and inferential. So I'm not saying that I finished my balance sheet and you know your profit and loss. It is required, yes. But beyond that, we are going and trying to say, are you supporting, interpreting for profitability, judging solvency, looking at liquidity implications? So comparing financial statements and trying to judge how impact of direct or indirect expenses most strong in one place and how that is going to impact future. So what is happening? The emerging areas are becoming something like integrated accounting, full disclosure, analytical and inferential rather than mere consolidation and computation. If this is happening, accounting will not be disrupted. Otherwise, we are just saying that you are preparing this. So this is something which is happening in a big way now. The idea behind this is maybe 30, 35 years back, when these processes were done manually, these processes means your journalizing, posting, balancing, trial balance, profit and loss account, these are all done manually. Then looking at the skills in preparation was so very important. But today, when these are all computerized and happening digitally, there is no meaning in saying that I have the skill for journalizing and preparing profit and loss account. The inherent skill required is in judgment, in analysis, in eliciting or reading between the lines rather than reading what is on the line, reading between the lines. What does this figure talk about? Why is this figure showing an enhanced value from the previous year? What is a comparative values talking about in terms of future implications? So be analytical, be inferential. That's why we're saying in accounting, even in your academics, we cannot always say journalize entries, post entries, prepare trial balance, prepare profit and loss account. You give them a profit and loss account, maybe one firm, two firm, or give them the results in the profit and loss account and ask them to infer, ask them to analyze, ask them to judge. This is applied research in accounting. So we looked at markets, we looked at financial services, we looked at the integrated model which stands there. And from there, we are also moving into the basic processes in finance, which we started looking at from a very conventional format. So research actually here, the research that we do in finance is actually addressing the disruptiveness in finance and accounting. That means we just don't want to have some products or services or outcomes which are just telling you how certain things have been done or how certain things should be done. We want some services or we want some outcomes which is going to support in making analysis of the results and trying to say, that's why integration, we want mergers and acquisitions taking place or subcomponents getting integrated. We want that to happen in a big format. And that is what we are actually referring to when we are talking about accounting. So that means, again, let me be very frank with you. We never thought that there was anything. You look at not only myself, you look at any university or any research centers. I don't think 30 years back anybody ever thought that accounting was something to be researched. There is no action in that. There is no applied research in that, because what is there in that? It is journalizing, posting, balancing, preparing financial statement. In that, what else should be done? And we are just reporting the past results. So if it is that, then there's nothing to be researched in it. But today we are understanding this as giving lots of inputs in a futuristic model, comparing between the financial statements of segments, of departments, of branches, making internal breakup analysis with the consolidated results, having integrated consolidated accounts, looking at inferential implications. So this has become something in terms of a new branch in accounting. And inside that, you have all kinds of accounting happening today. You have environmental accounting, human resource accounting, accounting for price change, inflation accounting. So all these things have got inputs for future judgment, which becomes part of your applied research as far as finance is concerned. Now, again, your theme in FDP, the first few days you spend, we are again trying to look at data. And conventionally in research, conventionally in research, we hear about researches with primary data or with secondary data. And we are also under the bogged impression that in many cases, you should gather primary data. I'm not saying that all research can always be done using secondary data and all. What I'm trying to say here is, what we have conventionally understood is that data is primary, which you collect from the respondents or collect from the field, collect from the person from whom you want to get it, or secondary, which is published. And it is available in reports, books, theses, whatever. But today we are in a concept called real-time data. Real-time data. And that real-time data is the data which I want at a point of time. We all talk about position statement and periodic statement. And we are saying position statement is as on a particular day, as on 31st December, as on 31st March. But today position has become so time bound, so real time, that position and valuations might change even on that same day. It is something in the morning, something in the afternoon. So real time data is something which is going to be very crucial for research. And that real time data is available in huge databases today. That's what I was trying to put across as far as applied research is concerned. The other day we were talking about a research work done on financial literacy. So somebody wants to do a research work on financial literacy in terms of the SEBI promoted investor awareness and in terms of the banking support which is there in a particular district in a state. So they're gathering data in two forms. One, the secondary data available with the policymakers and the regulators. Policymaker here is RBI for banking. And SEBI is a regulator for the capital market. So they have got lots of things published and saying this is investor awareness, these are the no's, these are the KYCs, this, that, and all. They were talking about all those elements. And these people, this researcher, they started gathering data from the respondents and asking them, are you aware about this scheme, that scheme? Are you aware about KYC? Are you aware about bank? So then they said that, okay, through this, we are trying to get literacy. So when the whole work was published, one of the reviews gave a comment saying that, see, do you know these are some databases which are talking about the literacy values of all these things published on a real-time basis across the country. When you take data from one district on a primary basis, the database is so rich in data, so updated in data for the entire country. So when you have that real-time data, why are you running after something else? So this might not be the case in every case. Suppose you want to do loyalty or satisfaction of customers, maybe you'll have to collect rank data. But what I'm trying to say here is, if you look at some databases, real-time data is perfectly uploaded on a multidimensional basis in a classified form in a readily available for research format. You want region wise, you want state wise, you want district wise, you want all the equity, all the scripts traded in the NSE, BSE, you want daily movements, you want periodic movements, you want the day high, you want the day low, you want the value at a particular point of time. All these things are very readily available and you can very easily get that for your purpose. You look at databases, something like the Bloomberg or things like that. You want any information on managerial issues. You want any issue, any data pertaining to implications in terms of events which have happened. In your practice session, I'm talking about some events like that. Let us take the example of GST implementation, pre-post movements that have happened. You want to talk about all changes which have happened in the board of directors. You want to talk about all statements which have been made by the chairpersons of companies. What I'm trying to tell you is this real-time data is readily available in all these forms in different databases, which are easily catchable. So what is important? The data is already there. That's why we are saying big data. That's why we are saying analytics. The big data is already there, but the question is, how do you dig it in? How do you understand where what is available and how to dig into it and how to catch hold of it? So that is important as far as applied research is concerned. Where should I dig in? That is where I was talking about the psycho mapping in terms of spending patterns in a digitized mode. That itself gives you a lot of implication on preferences, on patterns, on choices which come up. So here, real-time data is the key. But then this big data, when it is data, perhaps it has no meaning. When I was talking about 1,000 students in a college, that is not that big. It was only 1,000 students and in one college. It's small. But even then, when I'm giving you 1,000 figures, I'm saying you want to study health. Okay, take this. There are 1,000 students named or numbered from 1 to 1,000. They have 1,000 heights. Each student has got a height. So 1,000 height values, 1,000 weight values, 1,000 blood group values. Like the different health parameters, all 1,000. It is just data. This real-time updated data on a huge scalable form on different sectors, on different firms, on different enterprises, on different business models, on different managerial implications, on different policies is available. Now the question is, what do you want to do with it? That is where we are trying to say which among this data, if I scan, I will get what result. That is applied research. That is applied research which we have to catch hold of. Suppose I am trying to look at financial statements. From the financial statements, there could be a lot of inferential analysis which can happen in terms of liquidity, in terms of solvency, in terms of future movements. And there could be lots of factors which can be elicited when you dig deep into it. But the digging that you indulge in is very crucial. So specifically in applied finance, it's not always necessary that you have to run after data. The huge real-time available data which stands out is something which you can take advantage of. Use the real-time data for solving problems in finance. And you can, there's a small mistake. The spelling mistake is there. You can create content that supports good financial models. So using data, and you can also create content. That means use this data, classify it in a form, and you are making that content available for certain financial models. That is how the financial service providers come up with, if you have got this much level of return expectation and this levels of risk appetite, we have something for you. They dug into the data available there and they are saying that this is what is most suitable for you. So it is a two-way thing. Real data available, how you dig into that for your applied research in finance, and how you use this data and make it available in terms of models which can be taken for the customized group for which it is intended. So these two things happen when we are actually talking about real-time data in a context and in a particular form in which it can be actually used.
Hello,
sir. Yes.
I would be interrupting in you. Can you please suggest any database where from we can get
I already
Sure, I already talked about some of these database, as far as advanced databases in finance are concerned, they are not always free.
Sir,
when we talk about Provis, when you talk about Bloomberg, I already referred to Bloomberg and all. You have to.
Yes,
it is one part of it. There are some part of the data which can be, which will be in the open access form. Say, for instance, suppose you want to know just movements, price movements about financial services, maybe capital market, and that is all available.
Sir,
but suppose I want to know.
Those are available, but I wanted to know actually. Sir,
data, that's what I'm saying. Suppose you want to know what the chairpersons, I want to know what Reliance Industry chairman has said in the last maybe 3 weeks in terms of all his industries. This perhaps might not be available in a paid form, but it is available real time. That's what I said.
Sir,
if you look at Bloomberg, it is available.
Sir,
it is available, but then you'll have to contribute or subscribe to that particular database.
Sir, like financial literacy, I wanted to know that across the state-wise or the district-wise or whatever might be the clustering, I wanted to know how much financially literate Indians are. And
it is available because rates. See, the only problem is when I'm saying literacy, suppose I'm taking my home district, I'm talking about it. There is lots of figures on in terms of banking literacy, in terms of RBI-based standards of literacy. But it, now what you are intending perhaps might not be the same. Say, for example, in the case of financial literacy, what is a case of literacy that is available? They might be looking only into banking. But in my research, suppose I want to know insurance, capital market, mutual funds, then perhaps that customized data, because this literacy that they're talking about might have been something only related to banking. So that way, perhaps the customized format might not be available in all database. That is based on what the researcher is trying to use it for his applied research. But on general parameters, how much of literacy exists in different states, how much of financial inclusion is there in each district, these are all you look at. There is, even in RBI site, open access, there is something called statistics.
Yes.
So you look at that, you see, it is free. It is free, it is available. But when I'm talking about Provis and Bloomberg and all, everything is not free. But there are databases, and many of these databases are available in you go to IIT Chennai and you look at the Department of Finance there, they have subscribed to some of those databases. Some research universities have also subscribed to some databases where they get real-time data, daily movements, and it is updated real-time. That when I'm saying what the BO, the board of directors meetings taken place and what the chairmen have said, suppose I'm taking at 12 o'clock, 4 o'clock in the evening, if somebody else has said something that comes into the database. That's why I said real time. So real time updation happens. But it is based on what you want, how you are having operationally defined something when you're talking about literacy and all. General format, common used, generalized purposes, they are available on in different databases, which was not so maybe 10 years, 15 years or 20 years back. That's what I'm trying to say. Now that real-time updated formats are available, some of which are paid and some of which are open access. But then the problem relate when I gave that example, we don't look into what is available in a wider domain and we supplement it with very localized information, which when you publish, somebody will say, why should you do this? On the other hand, you can take another alternate model. Say, for example, I take the national or the international or global database information available on a real time. And then what I do is, if I want to customize it for my purpose, I take certain samples for primary collection based on the added information that I want. But if you leave that larger paradigm left out and then go by a very localized format and say, this is the picture, then perhaps the analysis might not be complete. That's what I was trying to say. I think I've shed some light. It's okay with you?
Rather using it as a complementary, we can just use it.
Yeah, definitely. You
as
can use it as a complementary. Definitely.
As a
that's what I'm trying to say. To supplement that information, you can use it where you say that what is readily available is not fully suitable for my purpose. I have supplemented it. But keeping silent on what is fully available, maybe even for a global or a national perspective, and saying that I studied in a very localized format, I took everything on my own, which is then obviously somebody will ask, why should you do this? lots of information on this model on a national or global level is available. You have not touched anything on that, and you're saying that I did something at a very local. That should not happen. That's what I was trying to talk about. That is, in fact, the real relevance of real-time data that we are actually referring to. May I know who's speaking? Can you introduce yourself?
Sir, I am Shantanu Ghosh from Vidyasagar University.
Vidyasagar, good. Thank you so much. You raised that question. I think you're doing some research on this.
Yes, sir. Sir, on
good.
Financial
very inclusion. Good. Financial inclusion. Very good. There are lots of research on the same issue that you are talking about. That means broader paradigm information being left out, localized kind of things being taken to the primary. That means real data, real-time data left out and primary data taken. That should not happen. That's what I'm trying to put across. So shall I continue? I'll move, yes, with sir. The challenges which are happening. The challenges which are happening, basic challenges. Number one, market becoming more efficient and integrated. I mentioned that several times in terms of information symmetry, in terms of virtual space, in terms of fintech services, in terms of bringing them together. There's a huge integration in terms of the product class, in terms of the information base. So how do you address this challenge? That means some players who are not competent enough to integrate, they might become obsolete. So we have to address that challenge. We have to look at the infrastructure divide, because I have a system where all services are integrated, but the place where some customers reside is such that they don't have any infrastructure. We are talking about digital trading and all those things, but there are villages in India where there is no power, leave alone internet. So how do they? There's no access. They might not have good roads and all that. So that infrastructure break, which is set over there, does affect the kind of penetration. So when penetration is affected, then those customers, you want to do everything in a digital format, you want to integrate everything, but there is one group or one class who perhaps have potential to enter the market, but the integrated format does not suit them because they are not accessible on that same format. So infrastructure divide. The social divide, like difference in health, difference in education. Some states are very forward, some places are very forward. So they can understand, they can make themselves aware, they can indulge. But for the others, it's not so. So social divide, digital divide, already I looked into. That means we are talking about entering anytime, anywhere banking, anywhere insurance, anywhere capital market products, anytime exits, anytime switchover, no opportunity. Some opportunity comes up at 5 o'clock or 6 o'clock when trading. Immediately I log in. But in my place, I don't understand this because I don't have all these facilities. I don't get net connections over there. So digital divide could be yet another issue. Biases in the use of finance. That's why I said our mental frame. Something is always good or something is always bad. So I believe that money means it should not go into these things. Or I believe that allocation should always be in these formats. So these could be some of the issues which actually stand as formidable obstacles in the free flow. So those are some of the challenges, which definitely are challenges, but then that also could be part of applied research. How do you deal with this challenge? Perhaps you will require, as was mentioned here, a complementary model to tap these people also, as long as equitable development does not take place. But then over a period of time, that development, that divide is likely to be broken. So this is, I'm concluding this with this. What I'm trying to bring about is here, I'm just making a whole cap of what we try to cover. You are onto an FDP under the AICT training and learning program. And the theme is basically data, business data analytics or financial data analytics. So we need to understand that the huge, big real-time data available, when we move into a digital e-space in finance, has to be used to resolve problems that we have in finance, which are sustainable, even in terms of exploitation of markets, exploitation of customers, exploitation of systems, which have backfired. If you look at the subprime crisis 2008, the Great Depression, or the Southeast Asian crisis, these are all cases of exploitation which have happened because unsustainable development. We tried to create a huge demand for housing finance when it was not there. So bubbles are likely to work. We need to look at sustainable models, understanding the grassroots problems in the use and deployment of funds. And using that data, we have to probe into ways and possible means through which we can create knowledge. So that movement must be from the huge use of data to the convergence into knowledge, to the resolution of issues, to the final outcome, which is beneficial for the nation, for the economy, and the industry. So thank you so much. I don't know, I have a, I am having another session with you at 2 o'clock. So So maybe if there are some questions, how much should we take it now, or should we leave it for 2 o'clock?
Yeah, yes, 5 minutes we can take, sir, if in this session, any questions.
Sure. So if you, anybody please, wants to raise, yeah, you can do that now. And I'll give you what is going to happen. I'll just make a brief on that. What is going to happen in the practice session, I'll be giving you some issues on which analysis can be done. And I'll be giving you some time also. It will be very simple issues, some simple, very simple grassroots data. You have to just apply your mind and tell how you can use this analytically to resolve a problem. Okay, so maybe this, I'll spend some 15 to 20 minutes on projecting those issues before you, and you will do your writing, you will do your exercise on that, and you will mail it back to the organizers. So I think Dr. Biju will make an arrangement to get that back. And towards the end, after that time, maybe by 3:15 or so, I'll come back and give my version, but not after, not before you have finished writing, because you should not just write what I have put across. I'm trying to give a version towards the end. So it will be a session where you will have maybe 15 minutes, 20 minutes for the data analytic, analytical issues, which I'll project through slides. And then you will work on it. You will do your writing on it. And towards the end, I'll come and give my version on it. You may agree or disagree with the version, and we'll see what are the outcomes from that. Okay, so thank you so much. And now over to you for those who want to raise something on what I have discussed so far.
Very good morning, sir. Am I audible?
Thank you. Yeah, you're audible. Good morning. Good morning. Could you introduce yourself?
Yeah, this is Anita Raman from IBS.
Okay, good.
Quay Business School, IFHE University.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, let me compliment you for covering such an exhaustive topic in such a short time, bringing in
thank you
so many varied perspectives.
I mean, thank you so much.
All at once.
Thank you.
I have few observations and perhaps suggestions, or I wish to ask you some, probably, you know, to throw some light on.
Sure.
So correct me if I'm wrong.
Yeah.
One of the things, I mean, very well valid said is that, you know, industry academia interface, which you brought in the beginning, which is kind of missing, wherein that's becoming a challenge. You know, industry requires a huge amount of research, wherein the companies find that data privacy or security is one of the critical things. Which perhaps needs to be addressed. So this industry academia collaboration, how would you take it ahead, and what kind of platforms must be built?
Are there for it?
Very
relevant question. Thank you for raising this question. In fact, I kept something hidden when I put the first slide and when I concluded towards the end. And this question, if I'm not mistaken, was by Madam Anita, madam, your name? Anita Raman, madam has rightly raised this question. What I kept hidden was, in the beginning, I was trying to talk, and I think she got it right. She took the lead out of what I said over there. I was trying to say, I just put it theoretically by saying, what is the difference between applied research and theoretical research? But you know, when I said that, what was there in my mind? What was there in my mind was exactly the consultancy that we do in our own research center, the Department of Commerce, University of Kerala. Now, what is that is happening here? We have, as was rightly put here, a number of research work happening on financial inclusion, financial literacy, capital market, business risk return trade-off, portfolio management, this, that, and all happening. And we get consultancy projects. So when we get consultancy project, which myself I was undertaking as a consultant, the agency is coming and telling us that, sir, why not we have. So we were telling them that, we have one of our scholars who under a supervising teacher is doing this. Immediately they're saying, no, sir, we don't want that. You tell us what is your expense, what you want for our research in the industry, and you do it separately. Don't mix it up with your academic research. Why this is happening? And this was not so 15 years, 20 years back. I still remember when I was a student for my MPhil. There was a time when the people from the industry, they used to come and sit in the library and refer to the work that is happening on these things. And they used to say, okay, let us see whether there is one suggestion or one input which we can carry. Now, as was rightly pointed out by Madam, the problem here is they have lost faith in the academic research. I'm not saying all research is bad. Don't misinterpret me. What I'm trying to say, there are some very good research even happening now. What these people from the industry are saying is that in the research which we do in the academic institutions, which are only meant for gathering or what you call accumulating degrees, are only giving some information. We gathered some information because we are not going to resolve any problem. We are not going to give any solutions for anything, but we are saying that we are suggesting many things. We are not quite sure whether the suggestion is worth implementing and all. They are saying for us, what is important is only we have one problem, one issue. This is the problem. Now you tell us how to solve this based on the information that you get. This is exactly applied research. And for this, what is required? Now, the second part of the question that was raised, what is required? We need to actually know what actually is happening in the industry. Now, we cannot no longer in future. That's why I said disruptiveness in education, including accounting. No longer in the future can academic institutions have a standalone existence without integrating with the realities of the society. Why that is happening? You are seeing what the pandemic has brought before us. In future, what is going to be important is not just the academic degree. It is also going to be the supportive skill and competence which gets attached to that. That skill and competence will come only when you're associated with the realities of the outside world. And the realities of the society, the realities of the industry must get integrated into the hardcore research issues on which we are doing. Then in that case, even research funding is not going to be a problem. You look at the kind of research which is happening in the research team with SEBI or the research team with RBI or IMF, you'll see this in a big way. Now, what I'm trying to tell you here is, as you have rightly pointed out, if you have an academic industry interface, now that is happening in academics in many ways. A lot of new initiatives are coming up. Some of them have been mentioned in, say, for example, industry embedded academic programs. We are having it in BCom. We are also trying to get integrated your finance and investment clubs happening where you're trying to look at real issues. It's not that always you become speculative and always you trade big, but even small learnings by understanding the true issues. So we need to associate with them. In our university, we have created a Center for Industrial and Academic Collaboration. It's called by that name, where they bring in some issues, but even there we have limitations. Because the problem is when they say that, okay, we have this issue, why don't you do a research on that? We need to, as was rightly said now, we are also looking at procuring real-time databases for it and trying to see how this can be used into it. But then if you're doing a research only for the sake of a degree, it will not convey that purpose. So definitely, as you said, academy, industry, association for getting these problems, identifying those issues, working on those issues, it will be a good idea. And that is happening now in a very way. Mostly now it is happening in terms of consultancy projects. But why should we keep it alone with consultancy? We can integrate your consultancy with academics. You look at all the good teachers in great institutions across the country. I don't want to spend time naming any number of examples. They have actually attained their competence through consultancies. And the difference between the consultancy project and the other research that they do is these projects are actually associated with real-time issues. So getting yourself to be in touch with real-time issues will provide you with ample opportunities for understanding hardcore issues in applied research in finance. And there are many, many such issues which need to be researched using real-time data and associating. So such associations are definitely a welcome move, but it should go beyond just standing at the level of consultancy. It must get integrated with your master's program, with the MCOM projects, with the MBA projects, and also with all the teaching learning processes. So my classroom itself, my teaching itself is filled with live examples, illustrations, demonstrations. You come to a class, suppose you talk about book building process, an IPO. You just bring an IPO, which is the latest IPO, which has come out. And through that one single IPO, you look at the many concepts that you can talk about. Upper band, lower band, the issuing manager, the ASBA, all that concepts can be covered. And when that is done in the live case, the learner as well as the person transacting understands something which is live and happening. That will enrich the project and make you more skilled. So definitely what you gave is a valid suggestion. My entire presentation is talking about this very issue, right from accounting, financial services, financial markets. Link it up with the reality. Otherwise, you're going to face disruptiveness. So thank you so much, madam, for your question. I think I've shed some light on that.
Yes, sir. Do I have some time to ask one or two more?
Sure. Otherwise, Sure. You have. I think you can take. I don't know. You asked how much time they can take, Dr. Biju. I think I have another 5 minutes.
Still, it's actually we are running out of time. So please continue, sir. We can have five more minutes.
Yeah, okay. Sir. Okay. Yeah, so please continue.
All right. Yes. This is regarding you were talking about the integrated solutions, right? Building bringing money markets, then gilt edge securities and risk management and treasury, all put together in one solution. Now I had one edited book some time back that was, way back in 2006. Now here I find that these the STPs or the straight through process which have been seen are there with reference to MNCs, but there's not much of a these kind of platforms are not available for MSME segments.
MSME is true, but if you look at stock exchanges, you said in 2006, I think even before that, as far as stock exchanges are concerned, they have gone into STP, straight through processing. What I was trying to say, yes, if you look at MSME and if you look at basic commodity segments, which the platforms created for the micro, small, medium enterprises, yes. What I'm trying to say here is what these things will happen in a big way in future. I didn't say that as far as the capital market is concerned, in many cases, they have given an example of SBI. They are all like one shot, one stop. I can do all these things. But as you said, if you take unlisted firms, if you take MSMEs, if you take certain very small enterprises, which are even not moved into that in terms of perhaps startups.
Exactly.
Yes, there are lots of things which have to be done. I'm not saying that it is 100% integrated. We are referring to an organized capital market, basically running under the MSME BSE format. Yes, for those who are outside that and for the MSME segment, yes, there are things which are yet to be done. But even there, like for startup financing, crowd financing and all, there are models which are coming on that line. But then, yes, we need to take some more time to get into that. But it is bound to happen because the change which is happening in technology is very fast. So that way we have to see that it will come. It will percolate downwards even to the lower level, smaller enterprises.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you so much
for your valuable insights and
thank you and wish you all a very wonderful learning environment from University of Kerala, and we hope to associate with all of you maybe sometime in future also.
I have been part of this AICT team on the FDPs across the country. I don't know whether you, any of you have attended earlier, because the last one was in Chennai and one was in Coimbatore and all. So whenever we get opportunities, earlier it used to be a tough time because we had to travel. But now in this format, okay, I think with limited time, we do associate. So thank you so much. And over to you, Dr. Bijwa.
Yeah, it was a real faculty development session. It was, thanks a lot, sir, for the excellent sessions. So it was started with the past applied research in finance and touched the present and predicted about the future applied research in finance. And also real time, the relevance of real time data. Hope all academicians have got benefited out of this. And so we'll continue with us from 2 o'clock to 3:30, and I will explain, I will detail the about the practice sessions in the noon time. Okay, so we are right now leaving for break, and we will continue 11:30 with Aarti Omar session, Arch and Gash modeling. So thank you all. Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thank you.
Excellent.
Oh, and best wishes. Best wishes for all your future research, as well as perhaps, if possible, academic industry, associated learning, or learning from the society, learning from real issues. Thank you so much. Wish you all the best.
Okay. So, okay, we will have a break, and we will come back 11:30. The meeting is open to all.
Thank you. FDP.